Welcome to the Devin Nunes Podcast, breaking through the political noise, separating fact from fiction. From the San Joaquin Valley, the breadbasket of the solar system, here is your host, Devin Nunes.
Welcome back to the Devin Nunes Podcast. It is my pleasure this week to actually interview someone who has interviewed me for over a decade, when he was first on AM radio, broadcast out of New York, all over the United States, syndicated across the country. He was in San Francisco, Los Angeles, everywhere you can think of back in the mid-2000s. Then slowly he started to become a podcaster when nobody really knew what podcasting was. But now he is simulcast. He does a live radio show every night, still out of New York for about 4 hours, but podcasts at the same time. So let me welcome on the show for the first time, John Batchelor. John, congratulations on the success of your podcast, and thank you so much for all the years that you've had me on your show, where we basically converted into podcasting. And I think it'll be really interesting for the listeners this week to learn about why podcasting is growing so quickly. So, John, welcome.
Thank you, Devin, and a good day to you, Congressman. And also about podcasting, you've mastered the form. I understand you're new to it, relatively speaking, but you've got it.
Well, John, one of the things that I've done is I've realized that people really enjoy where I don't talk, because they get to see me talk a lot, whether it's on the House floor or pontificating on the news or on your show. So what I am able to do is bring on interesting guests, and we try to, you know, we have a great variety. But I will say I've learned a lot, and I actually use a lot of your guests, because I try to keep it, it's always normally about the news, but sometimes not necessarily. We try to keep it informative and keep it rolling. So John, you got into the radio business just kind of out of chance, and I think it's a fascinating story. I think people like to hear the story of what happened to you around September 11th, 2001.
Yes, wonderful. Quickly, I'm a novelist. I spent 30 years writing literary fiction, dystopian fiction, which means what if. And I enjoyed it, and I was still doing it in my 50s, which means that you're a success. If you're writing fiction in America in your 50s, you're a success. Doesn't matter what the paycheck is. However, a colleague of mine, Paul Alexander, was working in Bloomberg as a Democrat from Alabama, and the two of us enjoyed talking about politics. This is the late 20th century. And we fell into doing a weekly show for Bloomberg Radio about the Republicans and Democrats as they danced towards the election of 2000. It went well, and we enjoyed the talk. And then it came a moment where the broadcasters at WABC heard us do a show one night because we were invited in as guest hosts. It happened to be the night of the Supreme Court decision, Gore versus Bush. So everybody tuned in and heard these two guys, total amateurs, on the radio, interviewing people about what was a momentous decision at the time. George Bush was going to be president. This is early December 2000. We started our own weekend show in January of 2001, every Saturday or Sunday, and I committed us to long-form radio because we're not broadcasters. We didn't know how to punch buttons and take calls. So I would choose a different topic every Saturday night, and for 4 hours we'd talk about it. The space program or Star Wars or Lincoln's assassination or Kennedy's assassination. We bring on people to comment, historians and analysts. And on September 8th, Saturday night, 2001, I decided to do a show about the unfinished business of the near sinking of the USS Cole off of Yemen by terrorists. And I had occasion to connect to the admiral of the fleet at the time, Admiral Nadder, and also a counterterrorism experts from across the country, and one in particular, George Friedman, who told me everything I didn't know and invented for me this concept of Al-Qaeda. I couldn't say it properly. And a fellow named Bin Laden. 3 days later, the attack. And my board op that night, running the show, told the PD and the general manager at WABC, hey, John knows who did this. And they turned and they said, what? He knows what? Because this is during the chaos of September 11th. I was called by the program director, Phil Boyce, and asked to go on air on September 12th because he didn't want to put Dr. Laura Schlesinger, which is advice to the lovelorn in a perfectly good program, but it didn't suit a city that was on fire. Would you go on until we figure something out? And the punchline is, I've been on air ever since, Devin, on air ever since. The transformation to podcasting came later. That was the technology leading the way. Because in those early days of broadcasting from 2001 until, I'm going to guess, around 2007 and 8, we had cartridge tapes. We didn't have the digitalized MP3 files that we live on today. I couldn't look at a computer screen and record the way we can today. There was actually reel-to-reel in my studio, reel-to-reel tapes to record TV shows so we could play them back to the public. As the technology led the way, and as Apple created the iPod and followed that with the iPhone, we moved into an era where it was possible to record your segment, your thoughts on MP3 file, and then translate that into an iPod or an iPhone, just as if it was a piece of music. That was the birth of podcasting right then.
And what year roughly did you start your first podcasting, John?
WABC did it for me because I was ignorant of the technology. And I'm going to say the first year of the ability to access the show was probably 2005, 2006, somewhere in there, before the iPhone. So it was still through the desktop computer. There wasn't an iPad, there wasn't an iPhone, there was just the iPod. And that transformation happened between, I'm going to guess, Devin, because I don't have a chart in front of me, 2005 to 2010. By 2010, because the iPhone existed, it was possible for people to do that, but it still wasn't popular. Because right. We were making a transformation of technology.
Yeah, and then in 2011 and 12 timeframe, it's early on. There's a few popular podcasts, but I would guess, I don't know the numbers, but I would think that here in the last, 2 to 3 years, there's just been double-digit, not doubling or tripling or quadrupling of the podcast listener nationwide.
Well, the big transformation was when Apple committed itself to iTunes. That was the moment. When you had a national clearinghouse for everybody's contribution, and it was easy to access because the iTunes site is so stable. We didn't have anything like that before. There are a number of aggregators now that can pick up your podcast, but they do it from iTunes. Your iTunes account is where most people come and find you and listen to you. There are others who pick you up, and the same for me. We're in the same category, news on iTunes, and that made it possible for everybody to trust it. Early on, there was the usual anxiety about rudeness and dark words, that sort of thing, which you don't want to bring into your house. But iTunes cleared that off by saying that this content is trustworthy. And that began the transformation of the radio audience into a podcasting audience. They're separate now, Devin. That's what I've discovered. My radio audience is quite distinct from my podcast audience. Completely two different worlds.
I remember back in the mid-2000s, of course, the only way you were on the air in Washington, D.C., and when I was in Washington, D.C., we had a regular weekly spot. I think I was on Wednesday nights. I think I led the show.
Hotel California.
Talking about California. That's right. It was called Hotel California. You even played, and you would always introduce me to the famous Eagles song, Hotel California.
Right. And if we didn't play it, you'd complain, so we had to play it. Yeah, fine.
and then you'd play it on the exit, too, as I was exiting off. Right. And so that was live radio, and I actually distinctly remember because it was about the time that I got involved in the intelligence world and I had to really increase my amount of travel overseas. So the listener knows, on John's show, the John Batchelor show, what he does, he covers around 8 to 12 topics a night with different guests during each segment. Each segment's around roughly around 10 minutes. And so I would be overseas, John, and as long as I could get connected to Wi-Fi, I could download your show. And a lot of times I'd be 12 hours away on the other side of the planet, and I'd be able to download your show and then be able to essentially keep up to date as to what was going on in the United States of America. Because, you know, even at that time, when you go travel internationally, there was only CNN, which the only thing worse than CNN is CNN International. And I think it's a challenge across the globe because a lot of people around the globe view the United States through CNN. And as I think you know, John, and many listeners know, I'm in a lawsuit with CNN for fake news about me, which we've talked about before on the show, so we won't get back into that. I would say it was a tool for me to be able to stay up to speed what was happening in the United States. And John, you have on a great guest, Gordon Chang, who's been on this show and this podcast many times, especially recently with all the challenges in China. But also you'd have people from the Wall Street Journal editorial board, other newsmakers, interesting stories that would come out that you would read, bring them on. And then also books. I don't know how many books you read a week, but it's got to be at least two or three books a week. And then the books that you enjoy, you bring on those writers. And then you will do a whole series that you'll play over the weekend just on a book. And walk us through, how did you get involved in, and how did you come up with the concept of reading a book, bringing that author on?
You will recall that I was a novelist before I fell into radio. And I missed a deal of the author's life. Now, not all of it. It's pretty isolated. It's very similar to being a podcaster or a broadcaster. You sit in a room by yourself and you talk to make-believe people, except for they're real. Okay, fine. And because I know publishing and because I have a skill hobby of reading, especially long books, the publishers figured me out right away and would send me long histories, narrative histories, which I enjoy a great deal. And the authors are always eager to talk. So that I would spend 38 minutes, that's a broadcast hour, or 76 minutes, that's a broadcast 2 hours, or sometimes 114 minutes, you know, four segments per hour, with the authors and draw them out about their creation. You know, exactly why did you spend all those years away from your family? And so we talk about it. And in the course of the last 20 years, Devin, do you realize this is my 20th year on WABC? 20 years? 20 years? Mm-hmm. Yeah. If you're in Congress for 20 years, you're regarded as what? You couldn't find something else to do? So I just, 20 years of books, I have them, many of them in my studio, in my office. It piles up and you come up with themes. And then, you see, the whole point of this was I didn't know podcasting was ahead of us. We're in a place that wasn't imagined 10 years ago.
Right. The books are fascinating because they're evergreen. They're really ever ready,
right,
because
right.
You can go back. And I know, like, sometimes when you you seldom take a vacation, but when you do, or maybe on the weekend or over the holidays, you'll go back and essentially play the best of. You'll replay some of the books that you've read, you know, each year. And it almost feels like, even though I've never read the book, I feel like I've read the book because I've listened to it so many times. And it's a different perspective because it's not just, you know, reading what's in the book, but you're hearing it from someone like yourself who's read the book along with the writer, the person who wrote the book. It really brings out the life of the book. You know, why did you write this book? You know, how did you come about this? So give our listeners just a flavor for a couple of your favorite examples of the books, your favorite books or your favorite guests and authors that you've had on that you replay a lot.
Sure. And two things about the books. One, I know the book better than the author because I just read it. And the author finished it probably a year or two before. So I prepped them beforehand what we're going to do, where we're going to go, because there are an enormous number of details. Secondly is, when I hear those books again, I think to myself, I know that. I don't know that. What am I talking? Who is this guy? Because I replace the book that I just read with the next book that I read. My favorites are the construction of a narrative over many decades that is the 20th century. That's my favorite. Although I've explored the Civil War with equal attention to detail. And now I'm entering into the Roman classical period, where different authors approached their storytelling from different points of view. I mean, they had a reason to sell this book. Somebody bought it for a reason. So you find that reason and you go for it. And over many years, you develop an attitude about historical telling. I'm talking about nonfiction now.
Right.
Fiction doesn't do well in radio. The authors are charming. They're winning people. But to pull apart a novel is not possible. It has other ways of conveying art, verisimilitude, for example. But to take a narrative history, I just finished one on Attila the Hun, which is the late 5th century AD, the end of the Roman Empire in the West. And it's great fun to explore, for me, to explore what the author knows about this particular century. It's like a time machine. You enter into the 5th century and you become an observer of the fall of the Roman Empire in the West and the rise of the Roman Empire in the East, and how the barbarians, in this case the Huns and the Vandals, were able to exploit the weaknesses of the Imperium of the East and the West and take advantage of it. Now, why I enjoy this, I can't tell you, Devin. I just do. I mean, I'm a senior citizen, right? Mm-hmm. And reading is a safe sport. It's nowhere near as dangerous as what you do. Good heavens, go on television and try to explain things. And it's a great joy to talk to someone who's at the front lines of what we think about Attila right now, this Hun barbarian who was a quite sophisticated diplomat in dealing with the Romans. And I'm talking to somebody who is as knowledgeable of this subject as anybody on the planet. And that's a joy.
And as we've rolled into the age of the virus and time of the virus, as my oldest daughter calls it, you haven't been able to do much travel, but a new aspect to your show in recent years, you've been traveling to countries where you'll spend a whole week and you'll broadcast. I think you broadcast from Israel, from Kazakhstan, right?
Yes, you and I have traveled the same roads from Azerbaijan, from Kazakhstan, from Uzbekistan. Yes, Central Asia. Many years ago, I was in Taipei, but, you know, anybody can do East Asia. What the heck is that?
Nobody does those stands. They don't even, that's probably the least visited place in the world.
But when you were in Azerbaijan and had an audience with the president, Aliyev, he was most impressed with your knowledge of his country, especially the bathing in oil that's possible in a spa.
Now, John, you're giving away my secrets. I didn't tell the president at the time that I was listening to your show.
He was so impressed that a member of Congress, at the time, chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, would know something that, Devin, you were talking to him about something that was 3,000 years old, the pilgrimage that people would make on the Silk Road to bathe in oil. We're talking about petroleum oil. We're not talking about vegetable oil. Uh-huh. And then you were in Uzbekistan, you were in Tashkent, and then I went to broadcast in Tashkent. So it's a question of who follows whom here, Devin.
So last year, I think you were in Japan for a week, right?
I was. I spent a week in Japan, and what a joy that was. Oh, wow. There are two cities where it's easy to be a senior citizen who has comfort first on his list, and one is London and the other one is Tokyo. My goodness. And I thought to myself the whole time I was there, I'm very pleased that we're allies with the Japanese. This is organization that I've never seen before. And when you traveled in Asia, I followed your travels as well. However, you often went places you couldn't tell me where you were, so I didn't poke around. I didn't inquire.
Well, you are right that Japan, a longtime ally, probably your father fought in World War II. My grandfather was actually in the Pacific during World War II. And to see that country transform, you know, to know the opinions of my grandfather and the people his age, their opinion of the Japanese, because obviously they were killers, murderers. You know, it was a horrible time. Obviously lost a lot of people, not just U.S. troops, but also Australians and many others. So, you know, what they did to ransack the entire East Asia and, of course, the attack on Pearl Harbor. But to see the transformation into what really is a full-blown democracy has been quite a sight to see since the end of World War II.
And my favorite moment leaving Tokyo, I was at the Imperial Hotel, which is right there in the middle, and right next to the park, across from the palace. But to go around the corner to where they have the statue of Godzilla. Did you get to stand under Godzilla's statue, Devin, when you were there? I had a picture taken of me on my farewell to Godzilla. It's about 9 feet tall, and it's up on a platform, so it's above you. And that was my introduction to Tokyo as a child, when Godzilla swept in to destroy Tokyo. And there I was standing next to Godzilla. This is not a travelogue. However, I want to come back to the podcasting detail. All of that experience and all of our conversations over these last 10 years, those are podcasts. And sometimes I think to myself, is this radio or is it a podcast? It's indistinguishable today. If you're telling a story, you're telling a story that will be as easily consumed now or tomorrow morning or this weekend, because people tend to binge listen on the weekends, or a month from now. And that's the advantage that podcast lends. It's on demand. It's not the same as the radio audience that had to tune in a certain day or they'd miss things.
One of the things that I try to do on my podcast, you know, not all of them are evergreen, but we try to do deep dives into issues. I don't do a lot of live, late-breaking types of interviews because it's impossible for, you know, me as a member of Congress to keep up with the news, you know, with Fox News and all the cable stations and the mainstream media. It's impossible for me to provide that type of service. But what I see this is really a service that I provide to my constituents. And I haven't done an international show yet, John, but maybe I will do that. But I've done a lot of shows from my district, from the San Joaquin Valley. And we talk about it being the breadbasket of the solar system. Because I have listeners that are all over the United States and all over the globe, especially in Canada, I always got to point out my Canadian listeners. For some reason, I have a lot of Canadian listeners, John. I don't know why.
Well, you're on television, Congressman.
Maybe that's why. I don't know.
One of the joys about missing Devin's news is all I have to do is wander by the newsroom and look at Fox tonight. And then I catch up with Devin. Then people send me video packages. Did you hear what Congressman Nunes says? No problem. They send me a package. So I get to talk to you on Fridays after your week of broadcasting. Makes sense that you're popular in Canada. You're popular globally. It's another twist of podcasting, Devin. It goes everywhere. It's a global audience. And nothing's like that. Nothing ever connected to a global audience in the way podcasting can.
One of the things that I've heard a lot of folks that they listen to my podcast on Yosemite and the Sequoia Kings Canyon National Park, and we're the gateway. My district's the gateway to both of those national parks. And I've had people from all over the country back when we were out talking and giving talks and supporting as I go around the country and speak to many groups. I'd have people come up to me and say, I'm coming out to Yosemite next year because I listened to your podcast. So it's a way not only to bring all the experience that I get because I'm blessed to be elected by the people of San Joaquin Valley, but it's bringing that culture, that environment to the rest of the world, to the rest of the globe, including your show. You've been very kind over the years, but it really has been quite a tool. And I think it's still evolving. I think there's still more yet to come. And I guess that would be kind of my closing question here, John. Where do you see this growing from here?
Podcasts are extremely popular for commuters, extremely so. We've seen some hesitation during this crisis because commuting has been cut back, especially in the large cities. So what I think podcasting, the emphasis on podcasting for news reporting, because we're not comedians and we don't do sports broadcasting, is that you have a way of paying mind when you're doing something that is necessary, traveling to and from your office or taking long trips or on an aircraft. And it's an immediate form of us connecting to knowledge, connecting to information that doesn't wear you down the way reading does late at night, and that doesn't require you to sit there and do nothing else, which is what television does. So that's why I think podcasting will continue to grow in my lifetime and in yours, Devin. And I look for a Gen Z and your children, who I don't think your children have been named yet. Maybe one or two of them have, you know, the generation they're in, the one that follows the millennials. I believe more and more we'll see podcasting become their learning tools, not just entertainment.
Well, my children have said that they like my podcast at night because it helps put them right to sleep. So I'm sure if that's right, because it's completely boring or if they just like hearing my voice when I'm not at home.
Devin, I actually have a suggestion for you because they say the same thing about it. We have voices. We have baritones that are not unhappy making. Let me put it another way. We sound polite, and that's very happy for people. That's just how we sound. I mean, God made us this way. It wasn't a choice. Our voices do not upset people, and that's a very good thing to calm down with.
Well, John, thank you so much. It's the John Bastrow Show, everybody. You can find him on iTunes, coming to a country near you, for those of you listening around the globe. But I'm sure John will be back on the road traveling. John, thanks a lot for being on the show this week.
All right, a great pleasure.
This is Devin Nunes. We'll catch you next week.
Thanks for listening to the Devin Nunes Podcast. We invite you to subscribe so you don't miss a single episode. And remember, you can download this podcast on iTunes or at devinnunes.com.
Storm clouds been gathering so long, I don't know.
The darkness around us leaves no easy road.
We started wondering if every road dead ends our dreams.
Wind whips the dust up and rain's pouring down.
Good people struggling in every hometown.
We started wondering if we even matter at all. Days. 'Cause
trial by fire like this.
It's nothing hard work and family can't fix.
We've got the power to save it all here in our hands. We'll take that hard road to happier days. Cause we kept our American faith. We're already half the way there. We'll take that hard road to happier days. Cause we've kept our American faith.
Paid for by Devin Nunes Campaign Committee.